Hi, this is Sean. In the second intro to particles video, I'm going to go over some of the particle attributes inside of the Nucleus node. So let's get started. So last time we created particles in a couple different ways, and one of the ones that we did was creating an emitter, or we emitted from object. So I'm just going to emit particles from this object. In the last video, we emitted points. In this video, I'm going to emit balls, and so let's just do that. So let's play the simulation, turn on shaded mode. Let's give ourselves a few more frames to play with. You can see those particles are coming out. So let's just take a look at what sort of things we might want to see, what attributes we can play with in terms of the Nucleus node. In the Nucleus node, we've got a bunch of forces. We mentioned gravity in the last video. There's air density, speed, wind noise. We can also use a plane, and turning that on lets the particles interact with a virtual plane here. You can specify friction or stickiness, which is kind of interesting. See the particles very stick when they hit the ground. The other thing that's worth noting is this, the solar attributes. In terms of SubSteps, and you can really crank this up when the particle system needs to interact more accurately. So specifically, the particles interacting with other particles, particles interacting with cloth, you might really turn up the SubSteps. But of course, that will increase the amount of calculations necessary. Also, you can specify when you want the particles to start. And you could certainly keyframe the emitter to, say, emit zero particles at frame one, then 100 particles at frame 60, and then zero particles at frame 100, setting keyframes. But you can specify that your start frame is maybe 90, and so now we can play this no particles until we get to 90, and there we go, we've got particles. You can also modify this frame jump limit. Specifies when you scrub along the time slider. It'll still do calculations. Like right now, if I scrub, you can see there's, it's dropping a lot of frames, but it certainly increases the amount of calculations. The other thing is you can modify these scale attributes. If you find that your particle simulation isn't acting the way it should, maybe you're making rain and the particles aren't falling fast enough, you could increase the space, or decrease the space scale. So let's just show that. Let's bring this much higher. Rewind. Yeah, every once in a while there's a sticking point here with these particles. But you can see that it seems like it's falling much faster. And let's go back to the Nucleus node. And that space scale is set to 0.2. If we set that to 2, now let's take a look at, and the particles will start at frame 1. So this is twice the space scale, so everything's falling much slower. Okay, so that's a really important attribute to know about. Scale. Okay, what else can we talk about? Let's just take a look at one or two of the attributes in the particle shape node. I mean, these are spheres, and if we rendered them, they would look spherical. But if you open up the shading tab here, we did that in the last video as well, and we sort of looked at some of the hardware rendered particles under the shading tab. You can see that it's called a blobby surface, and so there's this threshold parameter. And what that specifies is, as these particles get near each other, there's a threshold where they can actually merge. And I can turn this up. Right now I'm not seeing it in the viewport. But we certainly, let's make the particle size a little bit bigger. And then when we render this, we should see some glumping as these particles come together. Really crank the particle size. Let's see what that looks like. Yeah, you can really see the effect now of the particles clumping together. And this used to be sort of what you would go to in terms of trying to generate something that might look a little like water in the past. And so we've got something a little bit better in one of the next videos to show, but it's still worth useful in a few situations. So let's turn that off and put the radius back down. I think it was set at 0.2 when we started. So the final thing that I want to mention in this video is, what if you wanted to start your simulation? We talked about time, and in the last video I also mentioned the ability to cache your particles. Well, what if you wanted to start your, if you wanted to start with the particles looking exactly like this? Well, you could cache the particles and set the initial state. So right now we're at frame 167, it looks like this. So, and what is caching? It's storing the data of where all the particles are in a file. So let's cache like maybe just 100 particles or 150 frames of particles. Cache under end cache, create new cache. And now it's done. And when it's done, now you can script through the timeline because it's just accessing data that's already there. Whereas previously, when there was no cache, it would actually be computing on the fly. So you can actually save out your cache. And what else? You can set the initial state too. That was one of the things that I was trying to mention, is that maybe we wanted this to be the way the particles looked at frame zero. So how could we do that? We'd go into the end cache. And we would say, oh, the end solver. And we would go and say, initial state set from current. And so let's just. And then what we would want to do too is turn off the cache, delete the cache. And so now that initial state kicks in at frame one. And so now it will. Since I deleted the cache, it needs to resolve. So like right now we can't scrub across the timeline anymore. We would need to go back and we would just say the end cache and create new cache. So that's pretty much what I wanted to cover in this 8 minutes. Thanks so much for watching, and we'll see you in the next video.